a lovely full house again, and we are in the beginning of 2015. It is the bleakness of February, and how miserable is February, can I just say? it's lovely to have you all out tonight on a miserable February 9th, 2015. If you haven't been to Treadwell before, welcome. We put on these lectures in a spirit of love and companionship and friendship and a love of ideas. And we're now in our 11th year, and we can't quite believe it. Yeah, who knew? When we opened up 11 years ago, we were open for all of about 3 months before we had our first talk, and that's partly, the best way I can say this, we sell books in order that we can have these. Mm-hmm. And we love reading, we absolutely love reading. If you're a reader, then you know, The Guardian has just published a huge scientific survey that readers are much more sexy than everybody else. We're here to help. We're here to help. We sell books by day in order that we can have these events by night and to bring people who love and are passionate about their research and their ideas and their spiritual practices with people who are friendly and engaged and curious and would like to meet them. And 11 years of that, we're still going strong, and it wouldn't be possible without you all. So thank you so much for your support. If you don't know me, I'm Christina Oakley Harrington. I am Chief Slave and Bottle Washer of Treadwell. but tonight is brought to you, as I said, by a group of us. And tonight, Diane Cardell, Livia Filotico, Jacqueline Hay, Mary Adamoya, and Marco Visconti. We are your, like, help you have a good time for a team. Things to know about Treadwells, you know where the books are, very important. You know where the bar is, very important. If you need to know where the loo is, it's out the double doors and straight to the left. If nature calls you, please help sort yourselves out. Don't be shy. And the structure of the evening is our lecture that runs for about an hour, and we do questions afterwards, not during. But we do give a good 15-20 minutes for questions, and that is because we do it in a sort of full participatory way, like a good seminar, not one of those kind of rubbish lectures where there's one really sad question and everybody can't wait to get away. We just don't do it that way. We do it like, yeah, we're engaged, we're interested, let's talk about this sort of way. And then to cap it off, we invite you all to stay for a drink afterwards, and the bookshop will be open, and you fabulous people will be here, except the ones who have trains and babysitters. So, on to the reason you're here. Gabriel Toso is I'd like to be able to call him a friend of Treadwell's. He spoke here on Voodoo Flags a couple of years ago, and I was absolutely honored and delighted when he said that he would be willing to give this talk as part of something we both care a great deal about, and that is LGBT History Month. If you don't know about it, it's a marvelous institution across the country celebrating lesbian, gay, trans, queer history. And it's just a lot of people do events all around the country in honor of that, and this is our contribution for this year, and I'm so delighted that it's something that means a lot to him as well. Gabriel is a researcher in Haitian Vodou and has spoken not only here but also at the October Gallery, and brings an enormous amount of passion and insight to his subject. And I'm now going to give the famous nod and ask for the switch toward the front to be switched off. And I'm going to hand it over to you. Thank you so much. And I'm going to wait for the back because I have a small shop dog who needs to be attended to at the back. I'll come forward for questions.
Okay, well, good evening, everybody. So nice to see some old friends and a lot of new faces amongst you. And thank you, Christina. Thank you, Treadwell, for having me once again here. And as Christina mentioned, I came the first time about 2 years ago, and I gave a lecture on Voodoo Flag. And that lecture combined two of my greatest passions, which is Haitian Voodoo and religious art, especially objects used in ceremonies and in rituals. Now, this lecture has a more human element added to it, and somehow is more personal as well. And he talks about the relation between the LGBT community and Haitian Vodou, but also with religion in general. And I say personal because I was born and raised a Catholic myself back in Venice, and I have always some sort of you know, better understanding of the at times difficult relationship between Catholicism and gay, lesbian, bisexual and transgender people. Now, this brings me also to the structure of this lecture, and at the beginning we are going to look at this at times difficult relationship between LGBT community and mainstream religion. Then we go and focus onto Haiti and Vodou, and we compare and see what the similarities, also mainly the differences between Vodou and mainstream religion. We will then go and look at some of the gods, some of the Lua of the Vodou pantheon, and how some of those gods have or don't have a special relationship with gay, lesbian, bisexual and transgender people. We'll then pass on to the ceremonies, which are the most important part of the Haitian Vodou. And the two elements which I'm going to look at are the dancing element and possession. And finally, towards the end, we're going to look at what's happening in Haiti in the last 20 years, and especially looking at the gay community there and how things have changed, especially after the earthquake of 2010. Now, without further ado, as I said, the relationship between religion and lesbian, gay, bisexual and transgender people has not always been a simple and a straightforward one, and some of the authoritative bodies of those mainstream religions have viewed those relationships quite negatively. Next. This can range from quietly discouragement, explicitly forbidding same-sex sexual practices, actively opposing social acceptance, to execution of people engaging in homosexual act. Next. Now let's have a look at our brother and sister in Christianity. And Christian churches have a variety of belief about LGBT people. And this can depend very much on the type of Christianity. So for example, Roman Catholic Church welcomes people attracted to the same sex. At the same time, they teach that same-sex relationship and homosexual sex are sinful. So there is that kind of distinction. For transgender people, they recognize only the gender assigned at birth by God. Eastern Orthodoxy hold very similar views. While Protestant, depends. If you're a Protestant in America, or a Protestant in Europe, or a Protestant in Africa, you would have a very different approach to the LGBT community. How ironic, San Sebastian, one of the campiest saints. Next, our brother and sister in Islam. Now, when a man mounts another man, the throne of God shakes. Or twerk. The Islamic view on homosexuality is obviously influenced by all the different religious authority and the Quran, of course, and also things like this, which are sentences attributed to the Prophet Muhammad. But the mainstream interpretation is that sexual act between members of the same sex is a sin and is punishable, is a crime punishable. Now, despite the formal disapproval of religious authority, as I say, because of the segregation of women in Muslim society, and also a strong emphasis on male virility, it is not uncommon that men will seek some sort of sexual outlet with other men. So, next. By this, I mean that not necessarily they consider themselves gay, but men with men will have sexual intercourse. Now this is okay as long as you are the penetrator rather than the penetrated one. So that's that kind of idea. You have to be the macho man. You still have to be the big guy. And anal intercourse is not seen as repulsively unnatural so much as dangerously attractive. They believe that one has to avoid getting bugged precisely not to acquire a taste for it and thus become addicted, obviously. Therefore, it's not so much the penetration as the enjoyment that is considered bad, and deep shame is attached to the passive partner. I can only bring my own personal experience, and I travel in many Muslim countries, and I used to live in Egypt for 1 year when I was young and cute, and basically there was not a single day or night that I would not be approached by a straight Egyptian, Muslim Egyptian, who wanted some sort of interaction with myself. As I say, we don't use the word gay in Muslim society. Next. In contrast, transsexual can be more accepted. Next. For example, while Iran has outlawed homosexuality, people like Ayatollah Khomeini have allowed for transgender people to change their sex so they can enter a more heterosexual, healthy relationship. Now, this position is supported by many Iranian clerics, and the state also helps with the cost of the sex operation. And Iran carries more sex change operation than any other countries in the world apart from Thailand. Now, we have to also keep in mind that sometimes people don't want to have a sex change. And so it happens. Because it sounds, oh, beautiful, they accept transsexual. But sometimes, actually, they push you. So if you're gay, they say, oh, that's not good. So it's better if you become transgender. So they might push you towards that direction. Some people will be happy for them to pay for the cost, but a lot of people don't. And so a lot of Iranians have escaped and run away from the country in order to avoid the operation. And the operation, the pressure is not just from the government, but from your family as well. Let's talk about homosexuality, and is it punishable by death under Iranian law? Next. At the same time of all the sex operation, about 4,000, we'll never know the right number, but 4,000 lesbian and gay people have been executed since the 1979 Islamic Revolution. Next. And our brother and sister in Israel and all around the world. And if a man lies with mankind as with womankind, both of them have committed a detestable act. They shall surely be put to death. Their blood shall be upon them. Now, obviously, Leviticus, the book of Leviticus, is not very friendly with homosexuals. And we can see this is the more traditional approach of Judaism. Now, it's not all doom and gloom, and there are, amongst all those mainstream religions, there are liberal and progressive voices that consider the view of LGBT people more positively. And some religious faith do bless same-sex relationship and same-sex marriages, so it's not all bad. Next, also, historically, let's not forget, some culture and religion do accommodate, institutionalize, or reverse same-sex love and sexuality. And such tradition can be found around the world, and they have survived until the modern era. And I'm talking, for example, the Berdash, the Native American Indian, or the Hijra in India, and the Xanit in Yemen, for example. But we are all here for Haiti, and all here for Vodou. And I just wanted to show you those mainstream, just to refresh our mind and compare. And everything I'm going to tell you about Vodou, have it in your mind what we're talking about, the mainstream religion. Next. So what's happening in Haitian Vodou? Vodou by its nature would not be classified as a revealed religion. There is no central Vodou authority, so there is no pope, there is no imam. There is no official sacred text, so there is not the Quran, there is not the Bible. All this is already influencing the way you approach the LGBT question. If you don't have an authority who tells you, if you don't have a book that tells you. Vodou is a practice-oriented tradition, so very much like Buddhism or Shinto, Haitian Vodou is largely experienced through direct personal involvement. as well as personal practice for during ritual and ceremonies. So as I say here, Vodou is a practice one does, not a creed one believes in. That's a fundamental difference. Now, while many people outside Haiti do refer to Vodou as a religion, if you ask an Haitian what religion is, he will most likely say that it's Catholic. Haitians themselves do not use the V word very often. The practice of Vodou is referred as servir loi, serving the loi. Loi is the most common name that indicates God, or actually better, spirits or mystère. So when I say loi, I'm talking about the spirits that we interact and work with during the ceremonies. As I say, Vodou is not a body of belief, but a body of practice that illustrates particular belief. Now, while the vast majority of Vodouisans is also a Roman Catholic, and Catholic elements are really part of Vodou ceremonies, you can be a Vodouisan and don't have to be a Catholic, you don't have to be Christian altogether. Instead of following the moral doctrines of the Ten Commandments or the Sharia law, there is a general understanding in Haitian Vodou that what you do is what you are, and what you give is what you will receive. A Vodouisan understands that the thing you choose to do or believe, as well as the thing it chooses not to do or not to believe, will have an impact in his world. In the most basic of terms, people who engage in positive behavior will have a positive experience, and people who engage in negative behavior will have a negative experience. Makes perfect sense to me. Of course, evil can happen in the world and in one personal life, but this is never considered like a punishment from a vengeful God, but much more a message from the spirit world that there is something unbalanced that needs to be addressed. It's correct, it's not a problem. Also, we do not believe that it's a judgment day in which you will be judged according to your sexuality. This is not important. If a person has been called by the loi to do their work, nobody has the right to judge him. So it's a bit less only God will judge me, that we hear all the time, and more the loi have plans for me to not interfere. So with this in mind, next. God made man free. Man is free to do as he likes, yet responsible for all consequences. Everything I'm telling you, always have it in mind when we're talking about LGBT. Yeah? Haitian Vodou is a religion whose tenets have always been queer-friendly, accepting people of all sexual orientation and gender expression. Of course, Vodou is just one of the religions that came from Africa. If you remember, it was the slave trade, all those people from Western Africa brought to the Americas, and their religion interacted with the local religion and Christianity and gave rise to a new kind of religion. This is Vodou in Haiti. Also, homosexuality in Haitian Vodou is religiously acceptable, and homosexuals are allowed to participate in all religious ceremonies and activities. In countries, you have to bear this in mind, in countries where there's a large Vodou population, so not just Haiti, but also places like Benin, for example, or Togo, Christian influence have given homosexuality a social stigma. So there's always that Christian trying to mess things around. So as I say, Vodou is open to LGBT people. In Haiti, Catholic Church was always against homosexuality, but as we know, several priests are actually repressed gay themselves, and it is known that a lot of priests, especially French and Canadian, went to Haiti in order to seek and found some sort of relationship or sexual intercourse with men. in Haiti, and we will never know because of the record, so we just don't know. So this has happened, and Haiti did represent a heaven for them. At the same time, the Protestants have a very similar view. The Protestants in Haiti have a very similar view to the Protestants in America, because that's where all the money for comes from America. So they have a very similar view to the South Baptist Church. So God's gaze will burn in hell, that kind of understanding. So if on one side you have the Protestant were against you, and on that side you have the Catholic were against you, it's obvious that almost the only avenue for spiritual expression for homosexual in Haiti is voodoo. You know, you have those two main religions really against you, and so voodoo is open to everybody, so you feel naturally attracted. And so therefore there is a higher percentage of homosexuals in voodoo than there is compared to the rest of the population. And as children of the gods, men find an explanation for their homosexuality and also some divine protection. It is common knowledge that in Haiti a significant number of Haitian voodoo practitioners is gay. And LGBT people in Haiti believe that it's much easier to be open about their own sexuality in the voodoo culture. And as I say, in voodoo, homosexuals are not barred from any religious activity, so they can participate in all the service, and they can be initiated, they can be ordained. So you can have a gay priest, Ugan, or a lesbian priest, a Mambo. It's no problem. The gender is not relevant. Now, especially among the poorer classes, the lack of living space and lack of privacy, it makes sexual orientation very obvious. So it's very hard to, you know, you have to imagine if you have been to Haiti, you know, in Port-au-Prince, everybody is next to each other all the time. So it's very hard to be gay and try not to. So especially in the poorer classes, the feeling is that to be born gay or lesbian is the will of the loi, the will of the gods, of the spirits. I shouldn't say God, the will of the one. And usually, family tend to accept the sexuality of their son or daughter. Next. Now I'm going to show you a little clip from a film called Of Men and Gods. It was a documentary from 2002 which follows the life and explains the story of about five gay, transvestite gay in Haiti. There are some subtitles, I hope you can all read them.
Puis, son bagay naissant, c'est pas qu'on l'a pas qu'on fait ça. Depuis qu'elle levé genre là. Jean Lia et qu'on s'a levé, ça veut dire son bagay. Depuis qu'elle fait, son bagay naturel lié. Jean est là même qui nous t'a parlé, le bagaille. Jean est là et qu'on s'arrête.
La petite monde, comment qui ont été comportés?
Jean est là, comme si Jean que où elle est via et qu'on s'arrête.
Ça a comporté, il mettait la fille, tu connais la fille sous lui, mettait les bagailles, puis dans pile, il connaît mettre pantalon de fille, depuis le petit monde, c'est comme ça.
Malgré nous pas de vrai.
Malgré nous pas de vrai, mais nous avons ça de vrai.
C'est pas bon, Richard.
Et où même papa? Alors, et petit tout. Mm-hmm. Il était toujours comme ça?
Comme ça, comme ça.
Bon, mon histoire.
Ben, ma gore à ce mot ça. Ma gore à ce mot ça, mais moi j'ai fini, moi c'est lui-même. C'est content, j'ai un bon Dieu pour elle.
Bon Dieu pour elle. Si c'est mystique, si c'est naissance, mon Dieu pour elle comme ça. Mais depuis le petit, il a consalé.
Let's remember we're talking about real people. Yeah, this is not an academic lecture about something really abstract. We're talking about real people who have their own life in Haiti. And how beautiful this family really embracing and almost wondering what's the big deal. You know, why you even ask me those questions? Anyway, also it's good to point out that in Port-au-Prince, a few of the peristyles, some of the temples in Port-au-Prince are composed almost entirely of gay men and gay women, and homosexuality is almost an entrance requirement. it is also possible, you know, they stick together, you know. It is also possible for a lesbian mambo or a gay Ugan to have several lovers amongst the congregation. And they help each other, you know, financially, economically, they can help each other. Also, Ugan and mambo have a specific password and gesture that they do to recognize each other. And gay and lesbian mambo and Ugan have additional password to recognize their own sexuality as well. As I say, Vodou is an ancestral religion. It is not a fertility-based religion. So, this means that the majority of the members are not required by any religious law to reproduce. Therefore, homosexuals are not pressured to do so. Yeah, quite a difference with Christianity, for example. Haitian Vodou views sexual orientation as part of the way God makes a person, as we say. Sometimes this is used also as a justification, you know. I am like that because the God, you know, because the Lua have decided for me. So you have to, you know, it's never straightforward, everything in Haiti, you know. It is an explanation, but sometimes it's used as a justification as well. But the more important thing is that the presence of homosexuality in a congregation is considered morally neutral. So, when you have a ritual, it's a long ritual, and you have so many different elements. What's important is that all the parts, all the sections of the ritual are performed correctly. It doesn't matter if you are gay or lesbian or whatever, as long as you do the right dance and you sing the right song at the right time and you bring the right offering, that's the main thing. Next. So let's have a look one second at the gods of the Lua, of the Vodou pantheon. And Vodou is both monotheistic because it believes in one main god, the father, creator, bon Dieu, that creates everything, but does not interact at all in our world. And it's also polytheistic because it believes in the presence of all the spirits, all the mystère, which interact with us. Next. And I just want to look at a few groups of Lua. And the Erzuli Freda, Erzuli Danto. Now, Erzuli Freda symbolize feminine beauty, flirtation, seduction, fertility. Her preferred choice of animal sacrifice is pure white dove. She loves cakes, she loves perfumes, she's that kind of jewelry, of course. She's the patron of all those who seek to achieve aesthetic beauty, including artists, musicians, actors, models, fashion designers, and interior decorator. She's also considered to have a personal relation with gay men, especially the effeminate one, especially the campy one. Now, next, her sister, Erzuli Danto, she's the dark and protective mother of love, hardworking and solitary. Her favorite color is red and blue, or red and black. Her animal offering is the black pig. She likes to drink rum and smoke cigar. She's quite different. She's here depicted using the image of the Black Virgin Mary of Czistochowa. And here, naturally, this is baby Jesus. But in Haiti, it's not. It's one of the daughters of Erzuli Danto. And in fact, motherhood and the life of a mother is a crucial part of Danto identity. Now, lesbians are under the patronage of Danto, and she's a fierce protector of women and children experiencing domestic violence. Now, in Haiti, let's remember, marriage is largely reserved for the wealthy people, very few, and cohabitation is far more common. As a reflection of this, Danto is romantically linked with many other male spirits, and yet she's not married any of them. Instead, she's a single mother, so she has her children, and she likes to take care of them, themselves, and herself. We have to think that in Haiti, there is not much work. I mean, the situation is a nightmare, but there is not much work, so a lot of men will travel, often to the States, in order to find a job, and they leave behind those women with their children, who will have to survive the best they can. And that is the kind of relation as well with Danto. And she is a special patron of single mother. and she has been known to wreak terrible vengeance on men who abuse women. Now, Danto, she's also been considered, some people consider Danto to be lesbian, and some people consider her to be hermaphrodite as well. So she will appear to you, depending on who you are, the way she wants. Mm-hmm. In Asian culture, exclusively homosexual behavior is rare. It's much more common for a gay man to live with a lesbian and have children, and so on the appearance everything is correct, and at the same time they can seek same-sex partner. Gay women also, for example, they will have a husband who will sustain financially, because there's always a problem with, you know, resources and money. Mm-hmm. So they will have a man who will help them financially, and at the same time they might have a discreet female lover. Now, although she's a single mother, she's also a frequent participant in spiritual marriage. Next. What am I talking about? Spiritual marriage. Spirit marriage. Mariage loi. Now, this is a very interesting thing. Occasionally, a loi might ask the hand of a living. You know, they say, oh, I want to marry you. And if the living accept, if the human accept, then there is a proper ceremony with a priest and the wedding ring and the cakes and the guests and the party and the contract. Now the loi enter a spiritual binding marriage with a human being, promising various favor. In return, the loi might want one or more nights a month for herself. So in the designated night, the human is not allowed to have sex or even sleep with another human. Instead, we go in a different room, prepared for the loi, and with some offering. And that's how the marriage works. Now, while it is never required to marry a loi, some actually go through with it for various reasons. Now, just like a human marriage, spirit marriage is very serious, expensive, time-consuming, and a permanent commitment. There is no spirit divorce. Forget about it. And as with all the other ceremonies, we have to remember, nobody is excluded. So it doesn't matter what gender you are. It doesn't matter the gender of the loi. You know, if there is a marriage, it's a marriage. That is irrelevant. So LGBT community take part in spirit marriage as well. Next. Now the other group of family is the Ogu family, and Ogu, amongst all the loi of the Vodou pantheon, is probably the closest one to the heart of the Haitian, because he's the patron saint of Haiti. He's the warrior, he's the god of fire, the god of metal, he's the symbol of virility and masculinity. And he appears in he has many manifestation. In this case, using the image of Saint Jacques Major, Saint James Major, and is depicted here riding horseback with a sword, with a shield, you know, as a warrior. Now another manifestation is Ogu Ferraille. Now both Ogu Ferraille and Ogu Saint Jacques, are frequently fused or confused, and this couple could signify some homoerotic relationship. Now, according to Marcelin, a writer, this person here is Ogu Ferraille, so they're actually together in the same image, which could possibly indicate some sort of relationship between them. Next. And I cannot talk about the loi without talking about the Gede. And the Gede are the family or spirit that embody the powers of death and sex at the same time. And they have several manifestations, both as male and female. They are the intermediaries between this world and the next, and they oversee the transition through life to death, after life or rebirth. They are also lords of life and sex, but above all, they are tricksters. That's what they are. They often come to ceremonies, even uninvited, and they stir things up. Now, all souls will pass before they get there, hence the enormity of respect for them. Next, amongst them, I just want to bring up Gede Nibo. Now, Gede Nibo is the son of the head of the family of the Guedet, Baron Samedi and Maman Brigitte, is their son, and he's got similar function. He's usually portrayed very dandy and very campy, always with a cigar, and you can get the feeling of it. Now Maya Deren, we all know, depicts him as, and I quote, "Lord of eroticism, who embarrassed men with his lascivious gesture, confounding sex with sex, dressing women as men and men as women." Every Loi has a group of dances and songs connected particularly to that Loi. This is one of them. Guedet Nibor has a cinema anus. Just look at how Guedet walks. And obviously refer to inner pleasure of Guedet Nibor. The other two Guedet are Baron Limbaugh, Baron Lobby. I just want to mention because Berthiaud, and I quote, "These two Guedets were homosexual lovers. It teach a type of homoerotic nude wrestling at their school, believed to increase magical potency." Next. That's a sculpture from an artist, a recent sculpture from 2006. Again, a clear juxtaposition between sex and death. Next. Now those two images, they represent even the dressing up and the drug feeling that Guedet had. Now interesting, that one is Guedet Cholera. Now we have to remember that the family of the Guedet and all the Loi, it's always adding new Loi. It's never, it's not like you have 10 Loi and that's it. You always have new Loi coming. And this is Guedet Cholera. I would not be surprised if there was now Guedet Ebola, for example. That would not be impossible. Next. Now we have talked about the gods. Now let's talk about ceremonies. And I want to bring the element of dancing and the element of possession. Now let's have a look at dancing. And Vodou has quite rightly been labeled a dance religion. For example, the Banda. Now the Banda is a funeral erotic dance dedicated just to the Guedet. Funeral erotic dance just for the Guedet. So you will only dance for the Guedet. And it's both sexy and provocative. And there's a lot of hip movement. And it's performed by both opposite and same-sex gender couples, simulating same-sex and heterosexual intercourse, respectively. Now, I have a little clip. This great woman, her name is Blanche Brown, and she's initiated, and she's the best dancer ever, and she teaches a lot of the dances connected with Vodou, and here she's actually teaching her class. So it's not a ceremony, but she teaches her class and some of the Banda element, and I want to show it to you. And the music. But I've got another little video actually from this, taken from a ceremony, still a female mambo probably, that is dancing the Banda. Thank you. related to the banda is the guyad, and is performed especially at carnival. Next. Keep it like that. Keep it like that. No. Right. Keep it like that. Now, this dance is frequently linked with cross-dressing, transgender behavior, and sex, same-sex intimacy. Now, in 1936, another woman, Catherine Dunham, the greatest Catherine Dunham, she was a dancer, a choreographer, and an initiated. She wrote, "With nightfall, all possible remaining restrictions are automatically cast aside, and the play element becomes decidedly orgiastic. Homosexual activity is very common to this mass band. It is not at all unusual to see two men in embrace of the guyad." She also added that even presumably heterosexual men will, under the increasing momentum of the carnival, seek out persons of their own sex for the erotic dances. Let's have a look at the guyad. Let's remember that carnival is not just carnival and party, it's always connected with voodoo. Yeah? Always connected with voodoo. And in this case, carnival allows you the possibility to express your sexuality through a dance, which is the guya, which is a proper dance dedicated to the Gede family of Loa. Now, the dancing of homosexual men is, in particular, very much admired because they combine together the strength of the masculine body together with the voluptuousness of women. And as LGBT individuals are usually good dancers, they are very welcomed by the congregation and they earn respect through a good dance. Now, in that respect, I want to show you another clip from the documentary I mentioned before that explained very well this concept.
Quand vous frappez, on m'a assis sur ma divine à danser, et puis après c'est de sa fille, quand il faut de se tracer. Parce que tout le monde sait vous avez obligé. Vous aimez ça? C'est ça que fait, ils ont gangan, obligé de remettre, on m'a assis ici. Et puis si on m'en bat, obligé de remettre, on m'a assis ici.
Sinon, dans soi, aller sous qu'on danse, même petite pressée pas parler à tout le ou bibi.
Okay, so this idea that if you are a good dancer, then you're actually performing one of the important aspects of the voodoo ceremony. So, and as you know, gay and lesbian and transgender and bisexual can be quite good dancer, then we earn that respect. So, the priest will say, yes, bring the gay in, you know, they know how to dance. That's, and the other element of the ceremony I want to talk about is possession. Next. Now, unlike other religious practices, where deities and spirits are always separated from the tangible world of the living and only addressed in abstract manner, the Lua of Haitian Voodoo share the world of the living through transpossession. As we say, a Lua can ride a voodooisant who for the duration of the possession will be referred to as a horse. So what happens? Now, during the possession, the Lua take over the body of its servant and it uses to interact in a physical manner with the rest of the people. It is only temporary, it only happens, mainly happen at ceremonies, and the ceremony is made in a way to invoke the Lua to come and take over the body. So you do the dance and the singing and the offering so the Lua can come and take over the body and participate in the ceremony. Serving as a horse for a Lua is a duty and people are honored to do it, but it is not something that makes you any special. It does not indicate a special rank or level of achievement. Now, there's no way for me to talk about possession without bringing the gender, the issue of gender. And it seems to be an equal number of possession between male and female. Now, around the world, some culture might say that we are better at it, you know, like the man or the female, oh, we are better at it. But, you know, it is very much an equal number. However, I've done some research, and historically, it seems that female have a greater predisposition to transpossession. I just want to bring some example next. Russia. Women known as trekkers, the owl screamed, convulsed, and tore their clothes. Now, they believe by many people to be possessed by demons. These women were shattered by peasants and clergymen. Now, the Russian Orthodox Church played an important role because while moving more towards a more scientific explanation, they didn't want to abandon completely the idea of demon possession and exorcism. Next, closer to home, France, 1634, a convent of the Ursuline nun is said to be visited and possessed by demons. Now, there was an investigation by the Catholic Church, a local priest was named, brought to trial, eventually convicted, and burned at stake, more women being possessed. Next, in ancient Greece, mythology, or not very much mythology, but mythology and story, the Menads were the female followers of Dionysus. Their name literally translates as waving ones, often portrayed as inspired by Dionysus into a state of ecstatic frenzy through a combination of dancing and intoxication. So, if in the past psychology have taken this element to, as a proof that women are more emotional compared to the rationality of the brain of man, today many scholars think that possession is a feminist rebellion. So women take a sacred role in order to achieve some sort of power that they will not otherwise. Now, while many of those theories are condescending or sexist, the underlying data remains interesting. But what happened in Vodou? Within Haitian Vodou, possession are gender neutral. Of course. The Lua do not discriminate against homosexual and women. So you can have extremely masculine spirit, like the Ogul, who will possess a man or a woman. Or you will have very feminine Lua, like Ursuline Freda, who will possess men and women alike. Now, when the spirit comes, they honor according to their gender, not the gender of the body that they're possessing. Freda will be treated as a female, whether he comes into a man or a woman, and Ogul will be treated as a man, whether he comes into a man or a woman body. Next. Let's have a look at this clip.
On ne peut pas choisir si c'est une telle ou une telle qui va avoir telle ou telle trans. Et la personne, la trans, on ne peut pas dire c'est un homme, puisque c'est Ogun par exemple qui va venir, on choisit un tel va être en trans par Ogun parce que c'est un homme. Non. Ogun vient de la tête de n'importe qui, d'une femme, et Ogun transforme cette femme en homme. Cette femme prête son corps de femme à un esprit masculin. Et du coup, il est devenu un homme. Un homme viril, un homme vaillant qui est Ogun. Même les hommes les plus matures de la planète, les plus virils de la planète, et que tu tombes en trans par Yézouli, tu es devenu une femme. Tu prêtes ton corps à une femme et tu es devenu une femme. C'est une déesse de l'amour, c'est...
When you saw him, the gay guy being possessed by a ghoul, and he's got some drinks and then he puts it in his ear, you might wonder what he's doing there. But this drink is really powerful. It's not something that normally you'll be able to drink. It would burn you. Because he's possessed, he can do it and he doesn't have any problem. So he's actually proving you that I can do it, it's not a problem. I can put it on my ear. Sometimes they put it on inside their pants or whatever, it doesn't matter. It's just to prove that they have the energy and the strength of the one. Now, for many Haitian women, that's true also. Initiation into voodoo is both a spiritual responsibility and also a smart career move, because if you become, you know, initiated and you start a career in voodoo, it's a lucrative profession for sure, and also you can attain a great deal of social power. And the same is true for gay, lesbian, transsexual, and bisexual. So, you know, if you have problem in your daily life and then you become a Ugan or a Mambo, you can achieve a different kind of approach from the congregation, a different kind of respect. So let's have a look at what's happening in Haiti right now. Next. As we are seeing, Haitian Vodou is open to people of all sexual orientation. But let's not fool ourselves. This is quite important for me. So, the Haitian society, it might surprise you, but it's very conservative and quite homophobic. And this has to do a lot to do with the mainstream religion. So on one side you have a voodoo religion, which seems so open and so, you know, on the other, the majority of the normal people. So once you are in the voodoo ceremony or in the temple or with your, it's all fine. But when you're outside it, it's not easy at all. And openly gay can be ostracized in part of it and in the Asian diaspora as well. Lack of privacy as well, let's remember this. In order to avoid harassment, a lot of gay men will end up in a straight relationship, especially to avoid that kind of problem. And they will have children and all that kind of thing that we said before. Ironically, homosexuality has been legal in Haiti since 1986. But we don't really know what it means. There is no civil partnership, there is no same-sex union, there is no, the LGBT people can, we don't know if they can adopt or they can keep their own children. You cannot openly serve in the military. You know, we just know there's no hate crimes law specifically addressing the issue of gender and sexuality. The only thing that they have is the United Nations International Bill of Human Rights, but this is very little. Also, in Port-au-Prince, there is no Soho, there's no Voxer, there's no that kind of like gay area that you can be protected, and there's no something like that. So LGBT people are left a bit wondering, what does it mean to be gay in Haiti? You know, what do I do? You know, it's complicated, and yet, in all repressive, homophobic culture, LGBT people have found ways to express themselves and live the true, authentic life. Now, how open you can be queer in Haiti depends on your religion, on your profession, and the color of your skin, and all that kind of thing. Now, if you are, this is quite important again, if you are from a wealthy background, middle class, upper class, and you live in, not in the dense populated area of Port-au-Prince, but in a better neighborhood, and you have, you know, your nice friends and neighbor, maybe you can meet them in your house and have some sort of interaction. That it's okay. But if you live in the vast parts of Port-au-Prince, I say Port-au-Prince because it's a typical example, in which everybody's next to each other, what do you do? You know, it's very complicated. So how do you express yourself? So as we say, there are three ways. Voodoo, very good. And then the two ways, which are always linked with voodoo, is carnival and rara. Next. Now, Rara, the next. Rara Festival, a yearly celebration that starts at the end of Carnival until Easter. So the Lent period, we call the Lent period, when the activity of the temple is at its quietest. And Rara Band, which are formed from the temple, congregation from the temple, will parade, so they dress up, so you are allowed to cross-dress, as we can see, and they will parade, singing, dancing, celebrating the Loire, from neighborhood to neighborhood, from village to village, from city to city. And that is happening during six weeks. And of course, some of the temples, we say, they are predominantly composed by homosexuals, and so that's a way for them to express themselves with impunity, because it's a Rara festival. Next. Now, Carnival is another of the few times in which homosexual Haitian can be openly gay with a reasonable measure of security. Don't look at that, just listen to me. Andre Duvalier was the last dictator, official dictator. Andre Duvalier, it was a crime to be gay in Haiti, despite an underground international gay tourist trade. Mm-hmm. Let's not forget that. Now, after the fall of Duvalier, the society remained markedly homophobic, as I mentioned to you. But in Carnival and in Rara, you're allowed, a bit like we do in our Carnival, but you're allowed to express yourself and to do things that you're not supposed to do normally. Mm-hmm. And a lot of the elements are very sexual. There is a kind of like freedom of expression in sexual terms. And because it's sexual, there's also songs connected with gay and lesbian, and it's perfectly fine. That is not a problem, it's all safe because it's part of, we saw the people at the Guyad before, at the LGBT Carnival, dancing the Guyad. It's fine and it's safe, just for that moment. So this is a couple of songs that they sing. I just know I'm not a faggot, a dyke gave the explanation. Well, faggots and dykes, they are twins, they fuck, and they come. It sounds a bit rude, I don't know, but it is like that. And there is a lot of, there's a massive collection of songs that they've been used during those festivals. And in both Rara and Carnival, then our LGBT brother and sister in Haiti are free to be authentically who they are. Next, I could not talk about Carnival. I'm sorry, I'm rushing because the time is finished. I've got so much to do. I have to bring this photo, which is from my dear friend Leah Gordon. And this photo was taken at the Carnival in Jacmel in South Haiti. And again, it encapsulates many of the elements that I really like. Is very strong and masculine, and yet very very feminine, because of this dress gown. Is painted white face and the sunglasses, probably a reference to the Gedesh. So you have the voodoo connection. Is very much it's not a common gesture, but much more. This is who I am without apology. Next, when I was looking at this photo, this came into my mind. I don't know if any of you have seen all those images from Liberia. Now, we're talking about a period, late 80s and early 90s, in which there was a terrible civil war in Liberia, and came out the president, Charles Taylor, he became a dictator, now he's in prison for 50 years. But anyway, all his army, his personal militia, they were doing atrocity, killing thousands of people, raping, torturing, all that kind of thing. And they used to dress up with women clothes, you know, boa feathers and dresses and miniskirts and wigs. And it's like, why? We got really confused about that. I've got no time to talk about it. But I leave it with you, and we can talk about it later on. Next, but very interesting stuff. Now, as I say, Haitian homophobic. Now, Haiti was a colony of France. Now, everything connected with France, this usually upper middle class like to be associated with anything French, because it makes you look important. So the French language and the culture and the art and all the studies and all that kind of thing. At the same time, while they were a colony, the French did nothing. So all the physical labor was done by the Haitian. In that sense, the French were considered weak, and by extension, effeminate, by extension, gay. So you have that kind of clearly idea that if you are too much French, then you might be gay. In that respect, and I'm all French. In 1994, I'll just bring you this example. It's a great example. In 1994, this wealthy man came out from a nightclub got attacked and beaten up for 6 hours, allegedly for speaking too much French. Haitians have their own language, the Creole. And so if you hear someone who speaks too much French, you're like, oh, why? You know? Anyway, now I'm very much at the end. We have to see a couple of videos, and we'll talk about it straight after.
And you know, Christy, something happened a long time ago in Haiti, and people may not want to talk about it. They were under the heel of the French, you know, Napoleon III and whatever. And they got together and swore a pact to the devil. They said, we will serve you if you'll get us free from the French. It's a true story. And so the devil said, okay, it's a deal. And they kicked the French out. You know, the Haitians revolted and got themselves free. But ever since, they have been cursed by one thing after the other, desperately poor. That island of Hispaniola is one island. Mm-hmm. It's cut down the middle. On the one side is Haiti, on the other side is the Dominican Republic. Yeah. Dominican Republic is prosperous, healthy, full of resorts, etc. Haiti is in desperate poverty. Same islands. They need to have, and we need to pray for them, a great turning to God. And out of this tragedy, I'm optimistic something good may come. But right now, we're helping the suffering people, and the suffering is unimaginable.
Absolutely, Pat.
There's a direct connection between earthquakes and homosexuality. It was in Haiti. Haiti was attached to the Dominican Republic on one island. Haiti suffered far, far more than the Dominican Republic. And the difference in statistics with practices of homosexuality and per capita AIDS statistics. And then earlier today, we had the earthquake that went across the eastern seaboard. Cracks in the Washington Monument, broken spires on the National Cathedral, and still many people scoff and ignore.
Well, God didn't send any earthquakes to Canada, and we've had gay marriage for years.
Wow. 2010, it was a terrible earthquake, yeah? Mm-hmm. Terrible. Already for the country, which was a mess. So many people died, and it's not just death, but it's everything that is attached to it. And somehow everybody tried to find someone to point the finger at, you know, who is the guilty one. And again, it really went half and half. Half of the blame was to Vodou and all those satanic rituals that the Voodooists are doing. And the other half was the gay people. So if you're gay and Vodou, that's it. Mm-hmm. End of story for you. You were the sinner who brought the earthquake to Haiti by angering God. Mm-hmm. And the Haitian gay community has fought against the discrimination. But after the 2010 earthquake, things went really, really much worse. Mm-hmm. At the same time, in the rest of the world, we are fighting for gay marriage. And there is a lovely, you know, this wonderful liberal gay marriage everywhere, in Europe and South America and North America. So the gay community there thought, in Haiti, thought, fantastic, this is happening around the world, that we might take advantage and bring the attention and do it something here. Forget about it. Because as soon as they try to do something, all the religion group, doesn't matter which faith you are, they all got together and they throw this massive anti-gay march protest in Haiti. Show me the next video.
Yeah.
any excuse, even a homophobic march, to make a big carnival at the end. So, but let's remember the reality of it. So, as I say, you have, you know, it all looked very, very nice until now. You know, you have the Vodou ceremony, all good, carnival, fine, Barra festival, fine. And yet, you know, that's the reality for every day. You have a very conservative society, which is deeply influenced by religion, by the Protestant and by the Christian. And, you know, I've been there and I've seen those planes arriving of all those people who are trying to save the souls, but they can't save themselves. And it's really bad what they're doing. Really, really bad. Now, next. I almost finished, Christina, now, some people of the LGBT community in Haiti decide to put together themselves and create an active political, to give a political voice. Now, they're called Courage. I just want to mention them. They try to give a voice to the rights of the gay and transgender people in Haiti. Now, Courage is convinced that Haiti is ready to change when the community is ready to engage in a civil rights movement. Now, the need to create Courage was reinforced after the earthquake. So they decide, and I met the president, and we'll be in touch, and he's blessing this lecture and his, and all of us. Now, they thought, okay, we need to be more visible, we need to answer this, we need to be present, so we have to make people understanding that we exist and we're normal people and we're going to make marches and do things. Now, this has been good some ways, but it also backfired in some other way, because the more visible you are, and if your country is not prepared, you're going to have the opposite reaction and people are going to get even more nasty to you. Now, I almost finished. Mm-hmm. The last video I want to show you is by this lovely man called Errol Josué, who is an artist, is a singer, musician, he tours around the world, he's also a Vodou priest, he's an Ugan, and he's also gay. And I'll leave you with this song.
Depuis que je suis sorti de l'anguinée, il y avait son de moi, c'est moi-même aussi non. Depuis que je suis sorti de l'anguinée, il y avait son de moi, c'est moi-même au gros à chaud. Je suis sorti en bas de l'eau, moi volé dans la zère. Couillot, croyant pour moi-même, tourner la fumée, oh. Je connais ça me servir, la terre va trembler. Je connais nos vents et moi, le rêve va gronder, c'est moi-même au racino. Depuis que je suis sorti de l'Ouest, il y avait son de moi, c'est moi-même au racino. Je suis sorti en bas de l'eau, moi volé dans les airs. La terre va trembler. Je reconnais ça me servir. Le rail va gronder. C'est moi-même au racino. C'est moi-même au gros racho.
Thank you so much. I think I'm with everybody saying that was amazing. And we're now open for questions, but the way we do it is I ask you to wave your hand at me and then we'll call on you in order. And I ask the first one just to kind of get everything, give you a few moments to gather your thoughts and what you want to ask. I found myself curious about lots and lots of things, but one thing I was curious about your experience of going there and doing the research and meeting these people. Just being there on the ground. And my question is, what was something that surprised you most anything that really, really...
I mean, everything is surprising about Haiti. You know, nothing can prepare you for that country. But I think what is clear to me is very much the different currents, the different elements that are always at play with everything. Nothing is very straightforward. Nothing is black and white. Nothing is just male or female, or good or bad. And he also, of course, considering the struggle, he also reminded me a bit of our history in Europe, of what we went through, and we feel so easy here in London. And then there, do they have any support? You know, and so you understand why they go and decide to participate and be initiated in Vodou, because it seems to be the religion that can only, I mean, if you want to be a Protestant, or you want to be a Catholic, and you go to church, and the priest tells you, you go to hell, what do you do? You know, it's complicated. And I think that all those different elements, all those different forces at play in a quite small country, that will surprise me. Everything is not straightforward there.
Everything's not straightforward.
Yeah. I don't know if that answers your question.
Yeah, no, it's a great hands from the floor, starting with Aidan, and then Trevor at the back.
Okay, I was struck by that nasty homophobic demonstration, the kind of ecstatic chanting, the almost trance-like state of some of the demonstrators, and it reminded me of something that I had heard, that these Protestant fundamentalist movements are able to, in a way, mimic some of the characteristics of spiritual tradition like Vodou, and they have situations that could be said to resemble possession, for example, and that makes them quite dangerous rivals, doesn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. I think you go to Haiti. Let's say you are a fundamental Christian and you want to go to Haiti. Mm-hmm. You have to face the reality that everybody is into Vodou on some sort of level. You might not go to do your all your ceremonies, but almost everybody will have some sort of connection with the Loa, or will have some sort of, even if you don't believe officially you're a Christian or whatever, you're still gonna wake up in the morning thinking, okay, Loa, maybe I should do some libation, or maybe I should sing a song for you. And there is always that kind of understanding. So I think you're quite right. When they try to do something which is of a different religion, you have to face the fact that the people are actually accustomed to express their religion belief, to express their religion in this practical way. Yeah. So it's very physical. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So yes, you know, it shows in that protest, which is not just like marching with, you know, it goes and yeah, absolutely. Because everybody is at the same time, you know, Christian, Catholic mainly, and Buddhist. And again, forces that they don't go necessarily together. It's quite different also from the city and the countryside.
Yes.
In the countryside, it seems that the homophobia is not as marked as in the cities.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Right, we've got several in a row. First, Trevor.
Yes, you have this sort of perception, exactly what percentage of the people are involved in Vodou? Because you say on one side you've got fairly liberal, sort of Vodou, like the Vodou. We've also got these of a homophobic.
Yeah. So I think as long as if you're in the temple, and the congregation is doing a Vodou ritual, or you can go in the temple even if there is no ceremony. It's an open space. You know, the place is still. You can go there and spend time there. You can live there if you want to. So as long as you're there, it feels that there's an understanding that the Loa have the power of that space. It's a magical ritual space, so the Loa are strong there, and if they accept it, then you shouldn't interfere with that. As soon as you go out from that, so the temple become a bit like the gay bar, which in a way, and you can meet other people. And, no, sorry about cruising, but you know you can meet up and be part of that, you know, feel part of that. Group of society, but as soon as you go out, things change.
I'm surprised you've got that sort of almost split mentality, sort of outside, you can be very homophobic,
yeah.
Inside,
yeah. It's not so for that. And yet, if you go to Muslim country, they're all very homophobic and they all have gay sex. So you know, it's complicated. I think it's part of a lot of human nature is not straightforward. And even amongst us, I'm sure that we say something and do the opposite or other way around.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Sugar. Hi. Did you have your hand up? No. Okay. Yeah. Hi. Hello.
Sorry, you asked for written questions, but in advance, I didn't get a chance to see the script. In many religions, the LGBT people occupy a kind of sacred space or a role between the living and the dead. So the Burdash were doing this, the Native American shaman, and so we're often occupying that position. And some would say that queer people are called to this spiritual role, whether they're Catholic priests. I mean, we don't know much about the imams, really, do we? But, you know, there's clearly some calling there, I think. And so it was really interesting to see that within Vodou, it very much is a sacred space where people can go and meet each other and socialize and feel validated. Much like the gay bars used to be underground here in Britain, and we would kind of go into a closed room with, you know, blacked out windows, and nobody would sort of, and we'd be safe in there. And now we've got kind of, the blinds are down and it's okay. But it seems like that's how it is at the temple.
It is something like that.
The
also,
temples
also
there.
While you're at the ceremony, it allows you to cross-dress, for example. Mm-hmm. Let's say,
I have a second point to come on to, but answer.
For example, if you are a gay man, and you like to be quite effeminate and campy or whatever, and at the ceremony, you've been possessed by Yasuli. Mm-hmm. Mm. Now that gives you the justification to behave in a very campy way because you're possessed by the god of feminine beauty and flirtation. And I'm not saying that this is just, this is all, no, it's not just like that. But, you know, along Vodou ceremonies and the carnival and the Vara festival, which are also religious festivity, it allows you not just to meet the people and to be in the same space, also to express yourself. And I think dressing up is very much part of gay and lesbian. I don't know, but I think so, especially at the beginning. And also dancing, you know, it's very good way. You can be quite sexual with your dance, and you can have, we saw just individual, but you know, there's a lot of couple. And you can be, you know, men and men dancing the guyad or the banda, and it's fine. It's fine.
Okay. My second point was more thinking about the politics of it all, and hearing about Courage at the end, and that this being LGBT History Month, and they're kind of supporting us here. I'm wondering whether you're in touch with them, whether we could support them in maybe doing a collection tonight to donate to their struggle, and whether people would be interested in that.
Mm-hmm. Well, I have to speak to Charlotte Judy, which is the president. Mm-hmm. As I said to you earlier on, there has been some strong backfire from his good intention of being very visible in the island as LGBT. And, you know, you can find him talking on the TV, on national TV, or to the radio. So, bringing up a face, you know, to the people. Mm-hmm. So, look, we're not monsters, we're real human beings, you know, the face. But at the same time, they get identified. Mm. So, you know, it wants to be, but at the same time it doesn't want
to be.
So
it's very high risk.
And it's complicated. I heard him recently he doesn't even want to use the word LGBT anymore. Mm-hmm. He wasn't used, it's likely more different, just more vague. Also, why I use LGBT instead of queer? Because someone pointed to me, why do you use LGBT, you know? Queer is more maybe all-encompassing, but it is part of the LGBT History Month. And when you go and study the papers or videos and elements, they will often use LGBT. And I know that it's a limiting word. Maybe I should have used queer more often on during my presentation. But also, then I learned my presentation with the word LGBT. I didn't want relearning everything. Are we done?
It's actually quite mundane and practical in a way, but just some of the as you're talking about the when the Luar call people to marriage, and also the element of cross-dressing and ceremonies and things. I wonder how these things happen. For example, I mean, how will a white call someone to marriage? And also, with this president, yeah, are these clothes which are found in the temple? Do people bring them? Do people have them? Are they their own clothes?
Very good question.
So, the second part of the question, you can dress up as you want, so you can already arrive, you know, with more feminine clothes. Now, this is different when you get possessed. Now, when you get possessed, usually in a smaller room in the temple, they will keep clothes or objects connected with the god. So when a god comes, it feels more, you know, at home. If that makes sense. So it's not just the clothes, but there's all sorts of imagery and object, water and eggs, and all sorts of things depend on the loa. So, but before you do your ceremony and you're thinking about a particular god, you better have all your material ready. But this doesn't stop you also to go as well, especially in the gay peristyle. You can go dress up slightly more feminine, maybe. And we saw some of those men there that would have a slightly, you know, perfect eyebrow and, you know, bob and whatever. You know, it's perfectly fine. Now the first part, what was that
the
asking?
The
spirit of marriage. Spirit, yeah. What an interesting concept. it sounds really. Really beautiful. You get married with a god, and so if the loa comes to you, yeah, and that can happen in many ways, in your mind or physically, and he say to you, let's get married. You might not want to, but if you don't get married with the loa, you might not be happy. So things might happen to you all of a sudden in your life, and you think, oh, hold on, oh. And so, actually, it's a rhetoric question. Is it answer? You should say yes.
It's a proposal with a shotgun.
You should, free to do everything you want, but responsible for your decision. Mm. So you can say no, but, you know, things can happen that, you know, you might want to rethink about it. and you cannot really force a girl to marry. It's not like, you know, go home and, oh, I really want to marry, I don't know, Dambala, because it's the Greek, you know, whatever. So I go home and, no, it's not like that. It's the other way around.
Don't phone us, we'll phone you. Yeah. Okay, following on from the last question, what happens in the little room once a month, exactly?
you're not meant to have sex with other people, or to stay with other human, because it's like that day or that night you are married with the loa, so that's your full attention. So that's your partner. Mm. Now there is no sex intercourse with the loa officially. This is no sex magic. Mm. So it's more. It's mainly you dedicating your time and the space to your partner, your spiritual partner, and so you will have offering, because that's what they like offering, and you will have prayer, because that's what they like, and you will have songs and dance and just pay attention and communicate, and, you know, all the things that they are part of, you know, if you want to have a special time with your partner or your lover, you'll have some food together, and you watch a film, or maybe don't want to do that. Well, but, you know, you spend and you make sure, and you do it. Not because, oh, I have to do it, I can't be out. You know, and you do it because you want to do it, because you're going to get something that's changed. It's going to help in your life, you know. So it's a win-win situation, but it's demanding, it's time-consuming, and you cannot mess around. You can say, sorry, tonight I can't be bothered because I have to watch, you know, something on Netflix. You can also do that. If you are in the spirit of marriage, you have to follow the rules of the marriage, the contract. There's a contract written that you sign. Mm. So that's how it goes.
Wow.
Yeah.
Good heavens. Wow. We always promise to wind up the formal bit by 9 o'clock, so just a few closing remarks today. Many of you brought in glasses of wine, that's lovely. Probably safer, not, don't lift them up yet because we have little things to do. But when you go, better to take it than to step on it. If you have to go away, thank you so much for coming. If you can stay, the bar will be open. Gabby will be here and his partner Tom, who's been fabulous on the slides. And we hope you can stay in the chat and we're about as well. I think Livia will be on the till and Jacqueline. And Mary will be on the bar and will be dashing around. And please do come and say hi. But wasn't that amazing? Please join me in thanking you. I think probably Gabriel has more information on Courage for people who are interested. I know a number of us.